Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Washington Institute. I'm Dave Pollack. I'm the Kaufman Fellow here and also director of a bilingual Arabic and English blog called Fikra Forum, which I hope some of you may look at and possibly contribute to. You can find it on our website or just go to Fikra Forum. And it features comments and analysis from people actually in the region and U.S. expert responses to those. And we're going to actually have some posts about the conflict in Gaza coming up in the next few days and next week. I want to thank you for coming here, and I want to thank especially my fellow panelists, both of whom I've known and respected for quite a long time. Jeff White, who's another fellow here at the Institute, coming from a long and very distinguished career at the Defense Intelligence Agency, who will talk about the military situation. And Ghaith El-Omari, who is the executive director of the American Task Force for Palestine and a frequent, very astute commentator on the political aspects of the Palestinian-Israeli conflict and the diplomacy that surrounds it. I'm going to start with I honestly wasn't planning on doing this, but I was asked to start the discussion with a few analytical points about the internal situation among Palestinians and among Israelis as this conflict drags on. So let me start with the Palestinian side, and I'm going to feature first the results that were just released this morning from a credible public opinion poll that was done by Palestinians of Palestinians in the West Bank. This is just in the West Bank. Obviously, you can't poll in Gaza right now, or if you did, you'd probably get into a lot of trouble with somebody. And so what we have here are the results of a poll that was taken just a couple of days ago, July 19, 20, and 21, in the West Bank. And I think the results are quite interesting and a little bit counterintuitive. Most important of all, I think, for purposes of trying to understand where this situation is likely to go in the next few days, is the fact that on the West Bank, there is considerable support for an immediate ceasefire. And I think we'll see in a moment what views in Gaza were about that issue just before the major conflict got underway. But I think this suggests to me that Mahmoud Abbas has some significant political leeway in order to work on that issue. He is not likely to face, I think, anyway, major popular resistance on the West Bank if he is able to produce a ceasefire in Gaza, even without fully accepting all of the demands that he now officially has made his own, that Hamas is also putting on the agreement to a ceasefire. But what you can also see here in this first slide is that the public is, I call it, not just divided. It's not just that there are, you know, 60-40 splits, but also ambivalent in the sense that people say one thing and then they, a majority at least, says something else that is actually rather contradictory. This is not unknown in public opinion all over the world, and I think this in itself is an important finding. Don't take these numbers and say, well, the pollster must be wrong. Take these numbers and say, well, the public is conflicted about what it wants. And so even though more people in the West Bank support than oppose an immediate ceasefire, almost two-thirds say that their position is closer to Hamas on that question. And Hamas, as you all know, rejects an immediate ceasefire. Is this logical? No. But it shows that people have different sets of concerns, demands, ideas in their mind at the same time. Same phenomenon, perhaps even more poignantly, is revealed in the results of the second question. a majority say in the West Bank, again, remember, not in Gaza, a majority of Palestinians say that their side is winning the war now. But when you ask the same people who is likely to lose the most as a result of the war, a majority say that the Palestinians, not the Israelis, are likely to lose the most. Winning now, losing later, that's one possible explanation. Another possible explanation is that many people in the West Bank feel proud of the military accomplishments, as they see it, that Hamas has scored against Israel so far, and yet they also, many of them, understand, they're divided, right? This is not a sweeping majority. Many of them also understand that this respectable military showing, and we'll hear more about that from Jeff in a few minutes, by Hamas is not likely to produce significant political or perhaps any gains for the Palestinians in the end. Now, very briefly, what do Palestinians in the West Bank think about the major players in this drama? I suppose you could look at this and say that the United States and the Arab League are pretty closely tied in Palestinian public opinion. That would be a nice way of putting it. But what that really means is that, as you can see, Palestinians in the West Bank have very negative views of major external players, whether it's us, the United States, the Arab League, the Egyptians, or the United Nations. But closer to home, in the West Bank, and I would argue probably not in Gaza, although we can't really know that because there are no hard data, in the West Bank, Hamas is scoring, right now at least, significant gains in popular opinion. Hamas was always more popular in the West Bank, where people don't live under Hamas, than in Gaza, where people do live under Hamas rule. But today, as a result of the conflict, I think what you're seeing is a surge of popular support, or sympathy at least, for Hamas in the light of what's going on. And you can see a similar result as of at least a couple of days ago, and this is a moving target. The situation is changing so fast that even these results from a couple of days ago might already be a bit outdated. You can see a similar result looking at Mahmoud Abbas and Khalid Mishal, the head of Fatah and the PA, and of one of the major leaders of Hamas, where you see a more positive popular evaluation, again, in the West Bank, not in Gaza, of Mishal from Hamas as opposed to Abbas from Fatah. But what you also see here is that among opinion leaders, the results are quite different. And there is a divide, I think, in the West Bank, at least, between the elite, the journalists, the government officials, the academics, the NGO leaders, the major professional representatives of different important middle-class and upper-middle-class constituencies in that territory, on the one hand, and the general public on the other. For the first time in a while since I've been looking at these polls, what you see on the West Bank is that it's the elite, the opinion leaders, as they're called here, that is a little bit more moderate, a little bit more tempered in their enthusiasm for this conflict than the general public in the West Bank, at least today. In Gaza, now this poll was taken before the major hostilities started, but after, shortly after, the kidnapping and the Israeli campaign of searches and arrests that one could argue started this whole chain of events. In Gaza, one of the most, and I've reported on this previously, so I'm going to be very brief here, one of the most important findings from a Palestinian poll of Palestinians by Palestinians is that the people in Gaza didn't want Hamas to start this war with Israel. They wanted Hamas to maintain a ceasefire with Israel. And they wanted Hamas to observe what Abbas was saying at the time were the terms of his new unity government, which was maintain a ceasefire with Israel, renounce violence against Israel. And I would say that this is one of the more striking numbers that you'll see in any Palestinian poll. Here you can see that a large majority of the people in Gaza, as of late June, when this poll was taken, didn't want Hamas to run their territory at all. They wanted the PA. They wanted Abbas and his people to take over the rule in Gaza because Hamas was wildly unpopular among Gazans. And the last slide to make that point shows that it was Fatah or Fatah-affiliated leaders who had a majority of popular support and Gaza in Gaza as of late June. And the two major Hamas leaders put together, Ismail Haniyeh and Khaled Mishal, got a grand total of 15% popular support among Palestinians in Gaza. So much for Palestinian public opinion and the slides that I want to show. I was asked to speak very briefly about Israeli political calculations and public opinion in this situation. And I will say, I will make just three quick points here before I turn the podium over to my distinguished colleagues. First, there are no polls in Israel about what's going on, as far as I know. And that in itself is very interesting and unusual phenomenon. People are too preoccupied, understandably so, to take polls or to pay much attention to public opinion polls. And so even though most of the time there are polls in Israel several times a week, in the last 3 weeks, I don't think there's been a single one. Number two, there are, at the start of the conflict, there were serious internal divisions within the Israeli government about how to pursue Israel's military and political policies in this new situation. What happened, I think, over the last several weeks is that the far right inside the Israeli government and in the Israeli establishment has been marginalized, and you could see that among people who were advocating the reoccupation of Gaza or an immediate ground operation or the complete destruction of Hamas or something like that, including even the dismissal by Prime Minister Netanyahu of his deputy defense minister on those grounds. So far, he's kept his foreign minister, even though he's also making some rather hardline statements that are not completely in tune with official government policy. But I think that's, you know, a little blurrier and so tolerable for both parties. So the far right has been basically marginalized, and so too, I think, has the far left in internal Israeli politics. Tzipi Livni, or I wouldn't call her far left, but the more moderate voices within the Israeli government are supportive of Israeli government policy. And Tzipi Livni, for example, has recently come out stating that although she wants peace and wants a two-state solution and thinks that Abbas is a partner, unlike some of her colleagues in the cabinet, she thinks that the operation in Gaza should continue until there's quiet, until there's the rockets stop. Even Haaretz, the lonely voice of the far left in Israel, which somehow Americans are tempted to take as the real voice of Israel, it isn't. Even Haaretz has been relatively temperate and moderate in its criticism of Israeli government policy, although I can see some signs in just the last day or two that that's also beginning to change. They're beginning to find their more critical voice again. So I would argue that within Israel, among the public, as far as I can tell, without polls, and more particularly among the establishment in the government, what you have is a solid center. You really do have, I think, a pretty strong consensus about pursuing limited but still quite, I would say, significant military and political objectives in this conflict. And the center is shifting. Israel, which accepted a ceasefire right away, it seems to me, is now not so sure that an immediate ceasefire would actually serve what it now sees as its important interests. And one of those important interests, the only one, it seems to me, is to neutralize future as much as possible, to minimize the future military security threats that come from Gaza. And that is why, from what I understand, and some of this is just rumor or informed speculation, that is why I think the Israeli government is pursuing a ground operation and thinking seriously about expanding it in what will probably be only a limited time left to fight. The bigger picture, just really briefly on this, I think you could reach three tentative conclusions. Number one, the future security situation in Gaza will include not just the rockets and the missiles, but also the tunnels in a new way, not just smuggling tunnels, but offensive tunnels, tunnels dug deep into Israeli territory in order to pursue the kinds of infiltration operations that Hamas has shown itself capable of trying, at least in this conflict. And that might mean that, at least from the standpoint of the Israeli military, this will require high-level political decisions. That might mean that Israel will want to come out of this with some new arrangement on the Gaza borders. Not just at Rafah, not just on the official border, but maybe even some kind of neutralized zone inside Gaza's territory. On the humanitarian side of things, this clearly is a major human tragedy for the people of Gaza. And I think that the Israeli government would be prepared to consider significant improvements in that situation if the security issue is resolved in a new and better way. Number three, and finally for me, the larger issue of the peace process. Netanyahu has come out with a couple of important statements during this conflict, which are not very different from things that he was saying a month or two ago, but are ever more insistent and therefore quite important to pay attention to. What he has said recently is that what's happening in Gaza shows why Israel cannot afford to take the risk of letting the West Bank become like Gaza. Why Israel will need, in his view, to maintain the strictest possible security arrangements on the West Bank in any future scenario. And to me, what that means is two things. One, that whoever wants to revive the possibility of a two-state solution and of peace talks between the Israelis and Palestinians after the dust settles from this conflict should insist on adequate security arrangements in Gaza and about Gaza, or else the Israeli government will simply refuse even to consider any further concessions on the West Bank. And number two, that Egypt is probably one of the keys, not just to a ceasefire, not just to the future of Gaza and of Hamas-PA relations, but also to the overall peace process in an unexpected way. It's probably only Egypt that can cement, maybe even literally cement, a security regime for Gaza that will improve the situation and prevent another recurrence of this conflict in a year or two or three. And therefore, it's probably only Egypt, whatever the U.S. government or anyone else, Qatar, Turkey, or anyone thinks about President Sisi or Egyptian policy, it's probably only Egypt that can actually pave the way, again, almost literally, to a resumption of the peace process in the medium term. So with those comments, I will stop and turn the podium over to my good colleague, Jeff.
Thank you all for coming. It's a miserably hot day in Washington and all that, so we're grateful to see you all show up for this presentation. I'm going to talk about the military situation, the way the war has been fought so far, and then some of the implications that you can draw from that. I'm not going to give a scorecard on who's winning. That's totally tendentious. Will be argued for years and so on. But if you want to talk about some of those issues in the Q&A afterwards, we can do that. Okay, so this is Gaza. It's about 25 miles long, 4 to 7 miles wide. Most of the fighting that's gone on, or intense fighting, has gone on in this area, but also significant fighting in the Bet Hanun area and down here in the south. These three areas are major launch areas for Palestinian rockets. Okay, what's happening as of today? Fighting has continued. Okay, As of today, fighting is continuing. It looks like it's shifted more or less to long-range fighting, sniper fire, anti-tank guided missiles, and responding kind of Israeli fire. Air operations are by the Israeli Air Force are continuing to strike targets throughout Gaza, and equally the rocket firing on Israel is continuing. It looked like as of yesterday, it might have slowed down some. I think the total rockets for yesterday were 90, which is well below the average that the Palestinians have achieved. And negotiations seem to be, grinding along. You know, almost every hour there's an update on the progress that's being made or not made and all that. But I think it's fair to say that in the next few days, we might well get to at least a preliminary ceasefire or something to bring just the shooting to an end. But that's not necessarily, that's not a for sure. Okay, so every war should be fought for political objectives, right? There should be some, and military objectives as well. It shouldn't be just fought senselessly. I think this represents a sum of all the discussion that there's been about the Israeli objectives, demonstrate Israeli will, that is that they're willing to take on Hamas and its allies in a major fight. That Israel wants to restore quiet and go back at least to the situation that was achieved after 2012. There's now increasing talk about Israel looking for a demilitarization of some sort of the Gaza Strip. It's removing at least some of Hamas's weapons and infrastructure. And although many people would probably say this is not an Israeli objective, I think it clearly is. They are trying to minimize civilian casualties in this conflict, and we can talk about that as well. Militarily, the objective is to reduce Hamas's military capabilities, especially the rockets and especially the tunnels. The tunnels have risen, I think, in priority for the Israeli military as this particular conflict has gone on, although they have been concerned about them in a major way for the past 3 years or more. And I think the Israeli military also has a military objective of reducing civilian casualties and damage inside Israel. That's a defensive objective that no one really talks about very much, but that is one military objective they are pursuing. Hamas, again, nothing here is surprising. They are attempting to break the isolation and the siege. They want the prisoners that were rearrested in the wake of the killings, they want them freed. Hamas is trying to demonstrate its strength and resolve in this crisis. And this is sort of something that always comes up. They are trying to reestablish their resistance credentials, demonstrate that they're the main power inside Gaza. Their military objectives are to inflict as much damage as possible on Israel, casualties and physical damage. Major objective is to maintain the rocket firing in the face of Israeli operations. They are trying to present a robust defense against Israeli ground operations. In the 2009 CAS-led operation, basically Hamas military resistance on the ground collapsed pretty much. They did not fight very effectively against the IDF. This time one of their objectives is to demonstrate that they can do that. But they also have an interest in preserving their forces. They don't want to commit everything. They don't want to shoot every rocket. They don't want to see their forces destroyed in this particular campaign. For strategy, it's not too complex. Israel is trying to use its air and ground assets and also naval assets to compel Hamas to return to a quiet situation. They want to inflict as much damage as possible on the Palestinian military forces and infrastructure, dig out as much as they can. They want to do this in a military way, in a casualty sensitive kind of operation. Again, you hear there's a very great deal of focus in the media on civilian casualties. But that said, I think the Israeli military is still trying to operate in a casualty sensitive way in Gaza. And there's, of course, a media campaign that goes along with this to demonstrate that the Israeli operations are being conducted in a limited way, and that they are trying to, and that their cause is basically just. For Hamas, its strategy is to conduct a sustained rocket firing into the depth of Israel. And the concept of attacks into the depth are new for this campaign. They're firing as far north as Haifa and so on. And they want to do that on a sustained basis, right? They want to keep shooting rockets every day. So far, they've been able to do that. They want to disrupt the Israeli civilian life and economy, inflict damage, as I said before. And you can see the effect of that in the decision to suspend air travel into Israel. You know, they are having that kind of effect. They're looking in a military way to achieve some kind of image of victory. That is, an incident in which a large number of Israeli soldiers are killed, a settlement or town is penetrated on the ground, or the taking of Israeli prisoners. And you saw the other day with claims that came out very quickly by Hamas, the Qassam brigades, that they had captured an Israeli soldier. They're very quick to release that information. You know, now it's unclear what the status of that is, but they're constantly looking for some incident, some action that shows, you know, their superior strength capabilities. They want to prevent any Israeli deep penetration on the ground. They more or less accepted the initial Israeli ground penetration of a few kilometers. They contested it to some extent with long-range fire. But when the Israeli soldiers tried to go into the outskirts of the suburbs of Gaza City, they put up very strong resistance and did not want to see the Israelis, you know, succeed easily or even at all in that situation. They're looking to inflict casualties on the Israeli forces, both in the sense of troops, and I think we're up to 32 killed as of today, and damage to equipment, highly visible damage to equipment like tanks and so on. And they, too, have their own media campaign. They're trying to paint Israel as the aggressor in this conflict, paint Israel as focusing its operations on the civilian, and at the same time celebrate the success of their own military-type operations. So how's the war going itself? There is, I think, like three major campaigns in this war. One is what I call the rocket and air war, One is the ground war, and then the third is the media war. The Palestinian rocket forces, the estimates before the war began was that they had about 10,000 rockets. They fired a good number of them. The Israelis claimed to have destroyed maybe 30 to 40% of the rockets. So they have less now. Forces, the major rocket shooters in this conflict are the Qassam brigades of Hamas. Second to them are the PIJ. And those are the two groups that conduct most of the long-range strikes. The PRC, and we are now seeing, I think for the first time, we are some joint operations, rocket operations, between the PIJ, Palestinian Islamic Jihad, and Hamas, where they will actually coordinate rocket strikes on Israel. They've been able to sustain fire. Over 1,500 rockets have been fired. They were averaging about 120 per day, which is pretty decent rate of fire. Firing tended to be higher at the very beginning of operations. It's tended to go down somewhat over time, but not dramatically. We might be seeing a shift on that. Most of their targets have been at population centers in Israel, and most of those have been in southern Israel. Tel Aviv, Jerusalem have taken a lot of fire, especially Tel Aviv. And in this war, as I indicated earlier, they have now extended their fire into northern Israel. This is all, part of a long-term trend and development of Hamas rocket capabilities. They are, I think, targeting some Israeli military facilities, actually. They always claim that they're shooting at military targets. But in some cases, it looks like they actually are. They have named a number of actual military installations in southern Israel, which they have been firing rockets at. So I think some of that is true. And in addition to the rocket fire, every day there's a lot of mortar fire. right along the border that goes into Israeli settlements and so on. But also a lot of that goes against Israeli ground force installations along the border with Gaza. Rockets versus Iron Dome. This has got a huge amount of attention, I think, in the media. It's one of the things the media has really grappled onto. But it's useful to remember in thinking about Iron Dome and how it works and all that, is that it only attempts to intercept rockets that are determined to be a threat. So not every rocket that comes out of Gaza is going to be, there's going to be an attempted interception by the Iron Dome system. At the beginning of this conflict, the Israelis appear to have had 7 Iron Dome batteries in operation. Most of those were in the south. By this time, they now have 10 Iron Dome batteries in operation. They rushed three more into service during the course of the conflict, a pretty significant accomplishment. In the first 10 days, they intercepted 300 rockets, that is those that were determined to be a threat to a population area. And the accuracy and effectiveness is claimed to be 86%. You hear the figure 90%. And there's some talk running around the media, let's say, that it's much less than that, that the system actually doesn't work, and so on and so on. I don't think those are credible claims. The system seems to be quite effective. And if you look at the actual effects of Hamas rocket fire on Israel, the damage and casualties are quite low. So the system is, I think, working pretty much as advertised. The Israeli air campaign, I think it has two pieces to it. The one piece and maybe the major piece is the striking the Hamas rocket system or rocket infrastructure. The Hamas rocket system is not just about the shooting part of that system. They have launch units, they have storage areas, they have production facilities, they move missiles and so around. And the IAF is attacking that system in depth, wherever it is, basically in Gaza. So a significant proportion of the Israeli Air Force effort is going against that rocket system. The second part of the air campaign is against the overall Hamas military infrastructure. They're attacking basically a number of target sets, leadership, command and control, the underground storage facilities for weapons other than missiles, Hamas combat forces, and so on. So there's kind of two pieces, I think, to the air campaign. At least you can look at it that way analytically. Total strikes, in the first 10 days, over 2,000, probably up around 3,000 strikes as of today, and are averaging as many as 200 strikes a day into Gaza. And it's useful to think about the amount of strike activity relative to the same to the claimed civilian casualties, right? By the calculation I did, it takes about 6 to 7 airstrikes to kill one, Palestinian, right? And about 1.4 airstrikes to kill or to injure one, civilian or Palestinian, right? So there's the idea that this air campaign is being directed against the civilian population of Gaza just doesn't hold up, to analysis. There are definitely civilian casualties, and there's civilian casualties that are in the several hundreds, but it's not an air campaign, at least in my mind, that's directed against the civilian population. The ground war. This became, the air war and rocket war got all the attention in the first 10 days, and then the ground war began, and that's drawn, more greater and greater attention since it happened. There are different aspects to the ground war. It's not just one big, thing. The key aspect in this particular ground operation has been what I call engineering warfare. One piece of that is the Israeli army, the Israeli ground forces operating against the Hamas tunnel system. Something like 60 tunnels are estimated to exist. The Israelis say they've uncovered 30 and working to destroy 30, or they actually say they've uncovered more, but they've destroyed 30. So that as David indicated earlier, that's become a significant piece of the conflict between Hamas and the IDF. The second piece of the what I call the engineering warfare is this, the IED system, the improvised explosive device system that Hamas is using. They have hundreds, thousands, maybe of IEDs planted on Israeli potential Israeli approach routes into the area, and these booby traps. These are in fact causing problems for the IDF and casualties for the IDF. Allegedly, this was an IED that figured in the single most casualty-producing incident for the Israeli ground forces in this war. But there's also another part of this which you don't see much on is the bunkering of Hamas facilities inside civilian areas. That is the creation of strong points and houses and civilian buildings. The use of civilian buildings as fortified positions and to engage Israeli ground forces operating inside Gaza. It's a major effort by Hamas. Close combat, that is, directed fire engagements between Israeli and Palestinian ground forces. That has become a significant feature of this fight. Hamas, by almost all accounts, measures, whatever, is putting up a much better fight than they did in 2009 and cast lead, a much more determined fight and much more skillful, and it's producing a number of casualties. Part of this is the tunnel warfare. The Israelis are not just discovering tunnels, they're actually fighting for them. That is, the Hamas, in many cases, or in some cases anyway, is resisting Israeli efforts to seize a tunnel and take it over, and you're seeing small firefights around many of the tunnel entrances. Infiltration, another major feature of this particular conflict. There have been at least 5 attempts to penetrate the Israeli-Gaza border to get inside, either to engage Israeli forces or to attack a settlement. The effort to, if they were in fact trying to get to a settlement attack it, that has failed. They have not succeeded in penetrating any settlement. But in several cases, they've succeeded in engaging Israeli ground forces and inflicting casualties, including killed, in the resulting fire, in the resulting firefights. Fire support, both sides are using this. This is artillery, mortars, and so on. That's also generating a number of casualties for both sides. And maybe surprisingly, maybe not, there are few suicide actions. There have been a few. There's been more attempts reported. There was a suicide donkey and so on. But it has not been a major, feature of this conflict for whatever reason. It's really not in the Hamas fighting style. Media war, and I'll just accelerate my path through this. David's giving me the nod here. This is all pretty predictable. The Israelis are attempting to paint the Hamas and Palestinian actions in a particular way as a terrorist attack on Israel and Israeli civilians. They're trying to say that they're trying to attack the notion that their operations are negative or against the civilians and so on, and trying to paint their own success. And they conduct a number of specific kinds of information operations, in this context. And in the IO part of this, the information operations part of the war, has become a huge part. It's a major military operation, whatever you want to call it, in this particular conflict. Media war, same thing with Hamas. Again, none of the themes are surprising. They're doing a number of different things to promote that, and I would say they're having some success, but not total success. Israelis have been able, I think, to get some ideas across, at least with some of the media and some of their targets. They have not been, in my mind, Israel has not been defeated in the media war, even though Hamas enjoys, I think, some significant advantages in this particular part of the conflict. Okay, lessons learned. I think, for Israel, one of the big ones is air power is not enough, right? And this is learned almost in every war that's been fought since the invention of airplanes, right? That you can't do it, simply by air. And one of the main problems for the Israeli Air Force, which is, you know, highly professional and so on, is that their enemy has become mentally hardened. That is, they're used to being bombed. They know what being bombed is like, and they take various kinds of measures to deal with that. And the enemy has also physically hardened its presence against bombing. That's where all that concrete is gone, not just into digging tunnels, attack tunnels, and so on, but into fortifying, hardening the Hamas military infrastructure in Gaza. Iron Dome doesn't completely solve the rocket problem. It's important, but it doesn't deal with all aspects of it. Another important point here, I think, is that this incrementalism in ground operations definitely works to the disadvantage of the IDF. When the IDF moves, you know, step by step, when it takes a long time between steps, it gives the enemy a chance to adjust, to prepare for, you know, counteraction, to move stuff, to get their forces ready, and that's part of the problem I think we're seeing in this particular operations. And the last point I make here, maybe some of you can't see it, is don't neglect the ground forces. There's been an ongoing debate in Israel about cyber warfare, precision-guided munitions delivered by the Air Force, that this is more important than tanks, more important than armor personnel carriers, more important than the infantry and so on. You know, but in this war, like, you know, many times when shooting starts, you want a tank, right? You don't want just an airplane or some guy sitting behind a computer. For Hamas, Hamas is a learning organization. They learned a lot from Kassled, and I think they learned a lot in this crisis. In a crisis, initiate the fighting, right? If you let the IDF attack when you're not ready, you start at a very significant disadvantage in the fighting. In this case, I think Hamas, through its escalation of the rocket fire, you know, gained an advantage. They relearned for sure the lesson that Israel is heavily constrained by the presence of the civilians in the area of operations. And they've also learned, I think, again, reinforcing 2012, that they can operate the rocket system at least effectively, even under sustained air attack by the Israeli Air Force. And just I'll end with this slide. These are, I think, the major game changers in this war so far. The Iron Dome, even more than in 2012, it basically negated Hamas's capability to cause damage and casualties inside Israel. It didn't negate the ability of the rocket system to disrupt life in Israel, but it negated their ability to cause civilian casualties and damage. And this gave the Israeli government, I think, some important leeway in the fighting. I think the Hamas's capabilities in close combat, you know, with Israeli ground forces, I think that came as a shock to the Israelis. And I think that's going to have some long-term effects. And again, the tunnel system seems maybe simple and you know, not such a, you know, modern kind of technology and all that. It actually goes back to Roman times. But it's in this conflict that has strategic effects, right? It's protected the Hamas infrastructure against Israeli attack to a large extent. And it's allowing these cross-border penetrations, which could have strategic effects on the war. So with that, I will conclude. We can discuss more of it in the Q&A.
First of all, thank you all for being here. In particular, it was an honor and a pleasure to listen to Dave and to Jeff. I have learned a lot, but also you both covered a lot of the things that I wanted to cover. So there's a good chance I might stick to my allotted 15, 20 minutes. Unlike the pollster and the media, and the intelligence and military guy, I will not be using slides, but I will do what any self-respecting lawyer does and start with a caveat. The caveat here being that we are dealing with a developing situation, which means many things. It means, first of all, a degree of fluidity. I mean, David mentioned about how public opinion, even in the last 2 days, is changing, is shifting. People change their minds and their positions as well in very short time. And also the fact that this is a situation that is led mainly by events on the ground, not by policy prescriptions or policy ideas. And so there is some humility as one presents an analysis. And also, I mean, I'm speaking about things as they stand now, or at least an hour before we came here, which was the last time I checked the news. I'm supposed, as you said, Dave, to talk about the politics and diplomacy, but I cannot but start with the humanitarian. 600 loss, again, last I checked, on the Palestinian side, 650 casualties, above that, actually. A large majority of them are civilians. According to UN, count 70%, even by the most conservative estimates, certainly over half of them are civilians, among whom at least 100 children. This morning, the number that I read was 150. Whichever way you look at it, at the end of the day, Israel bears a significant degree of responsibility for these civilian casualties. When this is a position that is shared by everyone, from the President of the United States to European leaders, to et cetera, then there is clearly an issue here that needs to be taken into account. This is not, of course, to absolve Hamas. Hamas is also, by all legal, moral, and other standards, has been abhorrent in its behavior, firing indiscriminately against Israeli civilians, using humanitarian facilities as places to either store weaponry or to do you know, some of their command and control functions. So ultimately, though, because of the civilian toll, I do believe that a ceasefire is needed, and it's needed immediately, and this is the first and foremost priority at the moment. And I will get to that slightly in a bit. But also, to have to keep in mind that this is all happening in a context, the context of the continued Israeli-Palestinian conflict. As long as that is not resolved, we can expect to see one of those happen every 2 years, every year, every now and then. So this, the dust is going to settle, but the issues are going to remain with us. I'm not going to talk much about Israel. I think between the two of you, you covered that. But I would make some two observations. One is it's interesting to see that the real politics right now in Israel is not happening between the left and the right, but primarily on the right. And we might end up, after this is over, to see seeing Netanyahu in a similar place where Sharon was at a given moment, but without the tools that Sharon had to handle that political situation. The second observation that I note about Israel is, from the very beginning, Israel understood the importance of Egypt and used this as an opportunity to work very intensively and very closely and very effectively with the new Egyptian regime. And I think in that way they were wise, and they were one of the first to realize that the key lies in Cairo and nowhere else. Now, what I find interesting about this is the geopolitical and wider context that this is happening in. There's, of course, the obvious, the usual dynamic. Everyone's trying to rush to claim the Palestinian card. Hassan Nasrallah, yesterday or 2 days ago, offered to help and to leave Syria and come and save the Palestinian people, and everyone's waving the Palestinian flag, of course. That's usual and expected. But what I find most interesting and maybe most disturbing is the intensity in which this became a proxy arena for some of the other regional conflicts, particularly when it came to the role of Qatar and, to a lesser extent, Turkey. Qatar in particular, which had lost made all of its investment into the Muslim Brotherhood movement since the beginning of the Arab Spring, lost all of its assets in Egypt, in Libya, in Syria, etc., found this as an opportunity to come back into the center stage of regional politics. They failed. Everyone realized that Egypt was the key. The Arab League reaffirmed that. Most importantly, perhaps, the U.S. was consistent in its support for the Egyptian initiative as the primary and only way to move forward. So we've seen, though, this Qatari role, this Turkish role to a lesser extent, at the beginning playing a very negative role in it. And I do believe that Hamas's initial refusal to accept the Egyptian ceasefire was in part motivated by wanting to bring their sponsors back into the forefront. But that is now, I think, as things stand today, that is over. And one thing that is clear, Egypt is the key, not only to the Palestinian issue, but also the regional role of Egypt, I do believe, has been reaffirmed. I will go now into some detail in terms of the interests and dynamics that are defining things among Palestinians. I will focus on Hamas and Fatah, particularly Abbas. But I will note from the beginning that an interesting player that's emerging in all of this is Islamic Jihad. The joint operations that you talked about is not because suddenly Hamas and Jihad are in love, but I think because Hamas has realized that they cannot bypass Jihad. And equally, Egypt's unwillingness to engage Hamas as a primary player in Gaza has given Islamic Jihad more of a overall. Now for Hamas, I think they do realize, it's part of their calculation, they understand, that the longer the conflict goes on, the longer and the more civilian casualties start piling up, the better positioned they will be in any ultimate ceasefire deal. The more civilians are dead, the more pressure to end the fighting, and the more pressure on Israel in this particular case, and on Egypt to give terms which are favorable to Hamas. Hamas entered the conflict, in my view, with four objectives. One objective is to break its isolation. It hoped that Egypt will start again dealing with Hamas as the main address in Gaza. This objective failed. If you look at the Egyptian initiative, you know, some of the reporting says it was hastily prepared and hastily rolled out. I don't believe that's the case. I think the Egyptians were very deliberate in their lack of interest in consulting Hamas in formulating the peace, the initiative. Actually, more accurately, they consulted Hamas, but at an insultingly low level, which sent the message to Hamas. And they have failed to break that isolation and find themselves forced to rely on Abu Mazen right now as the address. They wanted to bring their, as I mentioned earlier, their regional sponsors as main players again, and that has failed. And again, to a large extent, thanks to a consistent US policy. They also wanted to leave this, to exit this round with a significant military achievement. Now, they are trying to construct a narrative that shows them as winning this war. And I think you pointed that well. And they did, in particular, what they are using right now is their ability to close Ben-Gurion Airport, which they see as a qualitative thing. Yet, the narrative they are constructing does not have yet a solid core to build around it. So it's still a very much a contested narrative. And I expect we will be seeing more and more attempts by Hamas to create a military victory, to come and say that we have established deterrence vis-a-vis Israel. So this is still at play. And finally, of course, they wanted a ceasefire agreement that improves their position and that gives them more deliverables to justify getting into this war. This is very much at play. And the target of this is not only Israel, and one would argue not even primarily Israel. It's Egypt, whether it's the Rafah issue or some of the other questions that they have put in place. They have defined right now what are the set of demands that are being presented not only by Hamas, but as of yesterday, Abbas actually found himself forced to adopt these positions. So while Hamas finds itself that it needs Abbas as its filter to the international community and as such will have to pay a price for that, Abbas finds himself in a situation where he is not the one setting the agenda, but having to basically adopt some of the terms that are set by Hamas, and even in his particular case, throwing one additional demand regarding the fourth tranche of prisoners who were set to be released at the end of the negotiation period. Abbas was one of the more interesting dynamics in this conflict. Only last week, I was on an event similar to this, and I proclaimed that Abbas is the biggest loser out of this conflict. I was wrong. Abbas actually is right now standing to win diplomatically. He is the address. Everyone's going after him. The Egyptians find him to be a very convenient and very useful player. The Americans are addressing him. So Abbas is emerging again in the diplomatic realm as the leader of the Palestinians again. Abbas's objectives were twofold, I believe. I mean, putting aside ending the bloodshed and putting aside all the humanitarian responsibilities that he has as the Palestinian president, he had two objectives. One was to be, again, emerge as the address, and he achieved that. And the second one is the objective of trying to reintroduce the PA into Gaza, primarily through positioning PA forces on the Rafah crossing, but now, as was hinted to earlier, to expand the PA role even beyond that. In this regard, it seems that, with these kind of demands, it seems to me right now that the contours of a ceasefire are becoming more apparent. It will have to include some kind of reopening of Rafah, probably with PA presence. And it's interesting to see Bougie Yalon, of all people, saying that this is not a terribly bad idea. There will have to be an easing of the closure. I think someone mentioned that. But it will be more complicated also, because there will be a need for a more rigid monitoring regime, given what we have discovered in this round. I think the prisoners issue is still the most complicated and the sticking point, and so far it's the one that I do not see how it's going to be resolved. Now, the fact, though, that, and by the way, in all of this, one interesting development here or component is the national unity, or more accurately, the national accord deal, which, again, early last week seemed like it's completely dead. Right now, it's re-emerging as a very convenient tool for everyone engaged. For Egypt and the Arab League wanting to bypass Hamas, they talk to Abbas as the head of the Palestinian polity, according to the unity deal. Hamas will be more able to introduce Abbas's forces into, or the PA's forces into Gaza, under the guise of the unity deal. So now it is proving to be a more useful construct. Now, I said that I see that the contours of a ceasefire are starting to clarify, but I don't expect a ceasefire immediately. Still, I think the two players, Israel and Hamas, have not yet achieved their political objectives. And I think, though, that we started this process and this dynamic whereby we are getting to a point where the pressure to conclude the ceasefire will soon, in a few days maybe, will become unavoidable. The question, though, of course, to me is, once the dust settles and once the euphoria and whatnot and the mourning subsides, what's going to happen next? I think for Hamas, their interest to emerge from this is, as Jeff said, to reassert their position as the resistor and to get some political gains. But I think their real objective in this one is to turn into a situation akin to that of Hezbollah in Lebanon, which is what they were aiming for, I think, at the beginning even of the unity talks. They want to be in a place where they're not governing, so no one can complain that the sewage is not working and the roads have potholes in them, yet in a position where, by maintaining their militias to be the ones who are the actual deciders on what happens in Gaza, very much as Hezbollah tries to do. For Abbas, he will try, of course, to regain some of his popularity and some of his lost popularity. What I did not mention is that Abbas, one of the reasons why in the first week he was inactive, was the fact that he entered this already weakened by the failure of the negotiations, but also weakened by his government's inability to continue working on the reforms that were instated by the previous prime minister, and the corruption that was becoming rife again, and the closing of the political space, and all of these issues. So I think as we look forward, and as we look what we are supposed to do afterwards, I tend to agree with what you hinted at, or what you maybe mentioned. I do not see a space right now for the starting of a big peace process that will deal with permanent status issues. I just don't see it. It's hard to imagine how this can succeed. Things are more complicated now than they were a month or two ago. But we have to make progress. And the progress has to be done in ways, in areas where we should be enabling the PA to deliver to its public, to deliver on the one hand by getting political dividend out of the ongoing and exemplary security cooperation that they've been conducting with Israel, even during these difficult times, but also to deliver by pressing the Palestinians and impressing upon them the need to go back to issues of good governance, to issues of opening the political space, because if that doesn't happen, what worries me, I mean, of all the stats that you mentioned, is not who supports whom or what have you, because these change regularly, but the solid number of people that we see growing every poll who do not trust any Palestinian leaders and any Palestinian structures. And that is exactly the kind of situation that creates fragility, that makes it impossible for Abbas to and others to stem the violence, and frankly opens the space for players that are, you know, potentially even worse than Hamas. So thank you for this, and I'm looking forward to the conversation.
For that really important analysis, I think we've heard some pretty counterintuitive ideas here from each of us, that Hamas is popular in the West Bank but not in Gaza, that Israel is trying to avoid civilian casualties, and that Mahmoud Abbas is probably a winner, not a loser, from this whole complicated situation. But I will leave it to you, the audience. I'm not even going to ask the first question. I'm going to go straight to you. We have about 20 or 25 minutes. Please, yes.
Dan Pollack from ZOA. I'm interested, only one of you has been raised. It's the only one who's really mentioned the FAA and the missile hit near Tel Aviv's airport. But in a weird way, doesn't this potentially change Israel's thinking about what they need to get out of this conflict? And might it actually prolong the time before a ceasefire.
Yeah, because the event's pretty fresh, you know, it's hard to say what the longer term impact is going to be. And it's just like the, you know, the 13 Israeli soldiers killed them one day, right? That had huge impact, and so on. But what does that mean over the course of the campaign, right? So we'll have to see if the flying restriction is lifted and people start going back in there. You know, maybe it doesn't mean so much. If it stays in effect, then I think it has more significant kinds of strategic effects. You know, in terms of how the Israelis respond to it, I think you can argue maybe, you know, two different, you know, scenarios. One is we need a ceasefire right now, or as soon as possible, to get out of the, you know, to get out of the conflict, to get the airport reopened and reduce the impact on the economy and so on. Or, you know, maybe the boogie camp is we need to expand the operation. We need to do more damage to Hamas. We really need to find those long-range rockets and eliminate them. So, you know, it's like everything else. It's hard to say, you know, how this is going to play out. But, you know, it can play out different ways. But the one thing that keeps occurring to me is we see these dramatic events. We put a huge amount of focus on them, and then 2 days later or 3 days later, you know, they seem to be just part of the overall story.
Thank you for the very interesting talk and presentations. Greg Gross, formerly at the Defense Department, is my name. How long will it take for Hamas to run out of rockets? They're using 200 a day. What is the estimate of that, and how long would it take Israel, if its desire is to basically take that out and get rid of the tunnel system? How easy would that be to do, and will they actually be able to do it? Second question is political. What is the likelihood, if any, that Israel might decide to escalate and actually decide to move in and even potentially overthrow the Hamas regime in Gaza?
Yeah, I'll take the question on the rockets. I think it's going to be very hard for Israel to take out the rocket system completely, because it's so well buried and so well embedded kind of in the Gaza structure. The Israelis claim 30 to 40% of the rockets of the 10,000 the tunnels. No, I'm are you talking? Okay, 30 to 40% of the rockets have been destroyed. Another 1,500 or more have been fired. So we're talking about maybe, you know, half the arsenal, the beginning of the arsenal. But my view is that Hamas will not allow that. They will not allow the running out. They will cut back. They will restrict firing. They will not show everything they've got in order to not get in a situation where they don't, you know, empty the clip, is a term that's, you know, been used in this, because it's going to be hard for them to to reload that clip, you know, over time. It won't be as easy in the past. Concerning the tunnels, it's unlikely that the Israelis will find them all. The longer they have to be in Gaza, the more they'll be able to find, the more they'll be able to destroy. You know, but the tunnel system is extant, you know, throughout Gaza, right? It's underground Gaza. This is where all the concrete went, right? It's not just the attack tunnels that, you know, extend a kilometer or two and then we'll go inside Israel. It's a vast, you know, some people say vast, right, underground system of storage bunkers, command bunkers, communications tunnels. It's, you know, rocket tunnels. It's a huge thing. There's no way that can be taken out or the rocket system can be taken out short of occupation of Gaza.
Yeah. Actually, the idea of Israel taking over Gaza has been raised. It has been raised, interestingly, by Tzipi Livni. I mean, it's been raised by some in the far right, but the one voice that stands out is Livni, who, as you mentioned, Dave, is on the left flank of this current coalition. I think, though, it was raised more of a threat than a real intention for a number of reasons. If Israel expands and takes over Gaza, then it's stuck with Gaza. The idea that Israel takes it and hands it to Abbas, it doesn't work that way and it won't work that way. The cost of taking over Gaza is going to be extremely high to all concerned, civilians, Hamas, and Israel. And the political cost for Israel, the political landscape is much more complicated now. I mean, what they would want is Operation Defensive Shield on steroids, maybe, to do that. And things are more difficult now than they were then, to a number of reasons. One of them is the nature of the relation between the U.S. administration and the Israeli prime minister. In Defensive Shield, I think Israel was less isolated internationally, had a degree of sympathy, and had an American president and an Israeli prime minister who had a chemistry that was almost unprecedented, maybe except for Clinton and Rabin. We don't see this right now. So I think the political space for Israel to do that is small. The operational space is small, and I think it will be, frankly, my own view here, be a disaster in every way, shape, and form. This is the kind of thing that will change the nature of the conflict for the next couple of years. Will not be just an escalation. That will be a game changer.
A question for Jeff White. I wonder if Israelis are sharing intelligence with South Koreans and Americans regarding the tunnels, because North Koreans are very adept at tunneling technology. They, you know, dug a whole maze under the DMZ and so for eventual ground invasion of South Korea, and they've also helped Hezbollah with tunneling. So I wonder if they're sharing intelligence. And then secondly, Hamas has deliberately targeted Dimona nuclear reactor, which is a textbook case of nuclear terrorism. If they do succeed in striking the nuclear, and it's outrageous, I mean, post-Fukushima is just insane. If they do succeed in striking the nuclear reactor, would this be crossing a red line for the U.S. and international community to strike Hamas?
On the tunnel intelligence, you know, this is, I suspect, yes, right? I think the Israelis are, you know, aggressive about learning about these things wherever they can and contacting, you know, people who have experience in dealing with it. I don't have any personal knowledge of that, but it's, you know, totally logical. You know, just like there's an international, you know, counterterrorism community, there's probably going to be an international counter-tunneling community, you know, people who work together, because they're effective, they're important, and they're strategic, as we see in this context. The Dimona strike, I think this is another thing that would have huge psychological impact, right? There would be, you know, frontline, you know, headlines everywhere in the world about Dimona struck, you know, but Dimona is not the size of a postage stamp, right? You know, there's a nuclear, you know, facility at Dimona. It's not exactly a soft target. It's, you know, it's a hardened kind of, it's not underground, but it's a hardened kind of facility. Hamas, I don't think, has the rocket capability to inflict any significant damage there that would lead to release of nuclear, you know, material and so on. But the notion of attacking a nuclear, you know, facility with rockets and maybe raising the risks of something like that happening, I think that, you know, that would get, you know, a lot of attention. But, you know, it's not something that's going to draw, I think, direct U.S., you know, any kind of U.S., you know, direct involvement in this situation. And I'm thinking that Dimona, you know, probably is pretty well defended by, you know, Iron Dome and other systems to reduce the chances or likelihood of a successful strike there.
What lessons do you see in this for asymmetric warfare. You mentioned that Israelis have been doing things incrementally, and I wonder if you could elaborate on that in terms of what I've asked before. I mean, politically, they have announced they're going stages, and internationally that may have helped, but militarily, where is Israeli initiative surprises? This seems to be like a textbook operation from that point of view.
Not on the Israeli side. It's not textbook. I think, I said this in my remarks, that there's, you know, for the Israelis, there's a real danger here in very carefully trying to, a military danger here, let's say, of very carefully trying to modulate and nuance your military operations to reduce civilian civilian casualties, to give the negotiations time to work, to allow for humanitarian ceasefires, to allow for people to move out of an area that you're going going to operate in. You know, as you said, it helps them a lot politically, I think, and keeps a lot of the pressure off them because they can say, look, we're doing all these things and it's at risk to our own troops. But in a military sense, I think it has negative effects for them. One of the advantages, I think, in CAS-led in 2009 that the Israelis had is they actually achieved at least tactical surprise on the ground. They had the initiative, and they put a lot of military pressure on Hamas's forces right from the beginning. They committed lots of forces and fairly, deep into Gaza. They cut Gaza in half with an armored force, right? In this case, they've been much more restrained in their actions, and I think they've suffered casualties, because of that. So if you're Hezbollah, for example, sitting there, in Lebanon, right, thinking about, okay, what's the next war with Israel look like? This is what you want it to look like. You know, you have the initiative. Israel's constrained by civilian casualties. Israeli forces won't operate in a decisive ground maneuver quickly. We can hide from the Air Force, those kinds of things. So for Israel, I think it's not, the lessons here are not, all of them are not good.
In the last remark, what struck me from all the presentations is we have here a very asymmetric situation politically, in which the Israelis are dealing tactically with the tactical situation, and Hamas is dealing strategically with a tactical situation politically. What do you think of the implications of that for any ceasefire down the road in terms of the broader situation?
Okay, please.
Paul Shem, University of Maryland. This is mostly for Rafe. It seems that Hamas is going to emerge from this probably strengthened because it has made itself a player. It was deteriorating before that. And also the reconciliation, as you said, will probably keep on. And Israel, of course, hates that, but that's a part of the baggage of dealing with Abbas now. So do you see this as really a net gain politically in certain ways for Hamas? That's the question.
I'm actually going to go counter to most analysts and say that I don't see Hamas benefiting from this in the long term. In the short term, I mean, in the immediate term, of course. Now there is they're defining the agenda. They have the war now is not seen as a war between Hamas and Israel, but rather between the Palestinian people and Israel. That's how most Palestinians see it. Hamas, at least in the first week, were the ones who are the only ones who were present, while Abbas was completely absent. Yet in the past, we have seen these kind of instances, and we have seen that this kind of euphoria subsides very quickly. And actually, in one specific instance, when in the case of Hezbollah in 06, I mean, Nasrallah had in the end to admit that had he known this is what it's going to look like, he would not have gone there. So yes, the initial euphoria you win, but in the longer term,
I see it, a lot will depend on the terms of the ceasefire, what will come out of it. But when Hamas has failed, you know, Hamas did not bring Abbas to speak for it, which is really what he's doing after he met with Mash'al, because they love Abbas. One of their objectives was to completely politically finish him in this one. Yet they find that they could not break their isolation. One of their objectives was to break the isolation. They have failed to break the isolation. And they have used the last tool they have to break this isolation. I think one of the things that they, once the dust settles, they start thinking about is why was the Egyptian media throughout sympathetic to Gazans, but almost unanimously vicious in the way that they presented Hamas. There, as I said earlier, the regional supporters have actually been dealt a blow. I think the Qataris thought they can come back, and they were dealt that blow. So all of that, I just don't see where the win is for Hamas. The unity is, you know, it's a loveless marriage that both sides got into because they were forced to get into. I think both of them were trying to get away with it the soonest that they can. Right now, they're going to be stuck in it a bit more, but I don't see this necessarily as working to the benefit of Hamas. Maybe, as the Egyptians see it, it's a tool to actually undermine Hamas. Now, the one last point that I would say here, in domestic political points, Palestinian domestic politics, just because Hamas might end up losing, I think it will lose, it doesn't mean that it will necessarily accrue to the benefit of the PA, because the PA has not positioned itself in a way to benefit it. I think one of the biggest crises, and I mentioned it and I will repeat it, is the lack of faith that Palestinians have with all of their governance and political institutions. And you will see a situation where, for most Palestinians, I believe, if things continue the way they are, we cannot trust Hamas, we cannot trust Abbas, none of them represent us, and you will see this drift. And this drift creates a weakened polity. That's my biggest concern.
I'm going to just jump in here for a moment and say, that may be a minority view, but I agree with it. So that makes at least two of us. I don't see Hamas as a long-term winner from this. What have they actually achieved? Ask yourself that question.
It's the Hamas leadership, right? The political leadership of Gaza. You know, three wars in 5 years, you know, hundreds, thousands of Palestinian civilian casualties, no casualties in the highest levels of Hamas, you know, major destruction, dislocation in Gaza, enormous punishment, you know, psychological punishment for the people. And, you know, the first duty of any government, right, is to protect its population. And, you know, Hamas is now three times in 5 years put its population, the population that it's responsible for, at risk without any ability whatsoever to defend it.
Peter Rosenblatt, I'm frankly surprised that none of the speakers have identified as a major Hamas strategic objective in the military side the placement of Hamas assets in such a way as to force Israel to generate civilian casualties. It seems to me that this effort, and it's clearly an effort, has been more effective on the ground in the military campaign than almost any other form of Hamas resistance.
Yeah. I think I alluded to some of that in there, that they wanted to portray Israel as the aggressor here, you know, against the civilian population. They wanted to operate from inside the population, you know. But for sure, one of their major approaches to the war has been to embed their infrastructure inside the civilian population.
And I mean, I did mention this also in my remarks. Hamas, this is not the first time that they have done it. If you look back at the Goldstone report, it specifically points to these kind of tactics. And these are, you know, by any moral, legal, ethical, you name it, grounds, are just reprehensible.
Thank you. Diane Perlman, School for Conflict Analysis and Resolution at George Mason. Two things. One, you and others have mentioned that in the Egypt negotiation for a ceasefire, that they insulted Hamas and didn't bring in certain players. So do you imagine a counterfactual, another process that they could have done where Hamas could have accepted the ceasefire, and it was a huge loss in the media war that Israel accepts Egypt ceasefire and Hamas doesn't. And the second one, you mentioned about supporting Abbas, and I think if we perhaps supported Abbas before 2006, and if he could deliver more to his people, maybe Hamas never wouldn't have won, and also if the elections weren't so soon. But also, do we have a role in supporting Abbas and deliverables now to make a difference?
In terms of Egypt, the only other scenario I could have imagined where what you mentioned would have happened is if Egypt were to capitulate completely and to accept Hamas's conditions, unthinkable. For Hamas, for Egypt, Hamas messes with their national security in the kind of most concrete sense in terms of the terror in Sinai. Hamas, more importantly maybe, is an extension of the Muslim Brotherhood from their perspective. And the Egyptians saw this as an extension of that struggle, which in their eyes is existential. And Hamas's willingness or interest in bringing Egypt's two biggest enemies in the region into the mix did not endear them to Egyptian decision makers. Look, I mean, I think we could have done, we collectively, we by this I mean we in the United States, but I also mean the Israelis could have done more to help Abbas, whether before the elections or during the last period of negotiations. I do think that the very, very tense relations between Abbas and Netanyahu, you know, Indic says that he calls Netanyahu that man, he doesn't even mention his name, have actually, I think, worked negatively in the conduct of what's happening right now. But also, I must say, Abbas could have done more to help himself. Or the PA could have done more to help itself. And here again, I mean, I'll sound like a broken record, but the issue of governance and corruption and opening the political space, while I don't see them as a precondition to anything, I see them as an important component of establishing the legitimacy and the credibility and the traction of the Palestinian leadership. And that's something that, from the outside, we can push for it, we can press for it, we can help create the space for it, but if the Palestinians do not choose to do it themselves, then it's hard to see how they will, you know, no matter how many diplomatic achievements you get short of liberation, will not be enough to compensate for that deficit.
Thanks very much for a great presentation. I want to take up the issue of proposals for a demilitarized zone. One element is preventing new equipment from coming in, which seems to me would require a sea blockade. Will Hamas and its supporters accept that part as a ceasefire? The land borders, of course, are something else. And the other is related issue, Jeff alluded to this, is the production facilities for assembling rockets and even making their own, which I assume are probably hidden pretty deeply underground. How do the Israelis ferret that out? Or at what point might they abandon their kind of cautious tactics and decide to sort of go for broke? They're already being accused of committing massacres and genocide and all that by some of the Palestinian leaders. At what point may they decide, well, since they're already being accused, why not, you know, go in full blast to try to root out these underground production facilities?
On the, you know, Hamas's ability to reload, I think that, you know, that's kind of what we're talking about here. I think they're going to have, even under the old regime, they were having real problems because of, you know, the Egyptians' aggressive approach to the smuggling tunnels, closing down hundreds of them, not all of them, you know, but hundreds of them. I doubt if they'll have improved access under whatever comes out of this, right? Their access is going to be restricted across the land borders, significantly restricted. As for the sea, they, you know, coming in along the Mediterranean coast, there's maybe some of that is going on. There were reports of, you know, barrels with weapons in them being dumped off the coast and then allowing the currents to, you know, bring them into Gaza and so on. But the Israeli Navy maintains, you know, constant, you know, and a, you know, interdiction of stuff coming to Gaza by sea. That's not going to change, I don't believe. We'll see in the negotiations. One of the things that Hamas has been talking about is better access to fishing, right? So it's, you know, what's the fishing for? Maybe it's for barrels, but I don't think they're going to have an enhanced their ability to improve their inflow of stuff. I don't think is going to improve. internal production, though, is a major part of the rocket system. They have the knowledge, they have the technology even to produce longer range rockets, maybe not the most longest range, but this isn't like to say rocket science, right? It's fairly simple weapons. They're unguided so far. The big worry is that they will become guided. They will put a GPS system on them and change their capability. So unless the Israelis have, what they call exquisite intelligence on where these things are, where the manufacturing and R&D and so on is, it's gonna be hard to get at their internal production capability. So we'll see. Hamas is not going to be bereft of rockets in whatever the next round is. They'll still have them. They may be more accurate. That's the next big change, I think. We'll see.
A couple of words. First of all, on the fishing. I mean, keeping in mind that a big chunk of the Gaza economy is from fishing. This is a coastal city. And when the PA and Hamas, for that matter, ask for the fishing, they're responding to the demands of a significant constituency in Gaza. In terms of demilitarization, I think there are two different ways. I think one is to talk about the regime of blocking and stopping weapons from coming. And I think this is something, you addressed part of it. I would only add that as we do this, we should think of how do we fine-tune it in a way that ensures that it's done for security reasons while at the same time opening up on the civilian population in Gaza. That policy that closed everything proved unhelpful and unsustainable. But to another question that was raised recently, which is the question of complete demilitarization of Hamas. It's one thing to talk about regimes for limiting, stopping. That I see as impossible. The Europeans called for it. Everyone calls for it. It is impossible because, you demilitarize in one of two states. Either you see yourself completely broken and defeated. They're not there yet, clearly. Or you see that there's an interest in shifting, like what happened with the IRA, strategically shifting your direction. I don't see that happening either. So the idea of demilitarizing Hamas, unfortunately, will not work. And that's one of the reasons why I do believe that even though we're going to go back to the unity deal afterwards, we're going to continue being unsustainable. Because as we've seen in Lebanon and elsewhere, when there is guns in politics, the guns always trump the politics, and the political process becomes unsustainable. So sadly, I do see that this demilitarization is, at the moment, not an option. But until that happens, I do not see quiet, and I don't see stability.
Is it possible that the Israelis may begin to have some issues about munitions, either Iron Dome munitions or offensive munitions? And, do they manufacture, some of that come from the U.S.? And then second and finally, electricity. Are the Israelis still providing electricity to Gaza? And if so, why does that not enter into the calculation? And is there any other conflict in history where you continue to provide electricity to your attacker?
Electricity is being provided intermittently right now because periodically the power grid gets, disrupted.
Yes.
In some case.
Yes.
Or hits.
Right. Okay, I'll try to answer that as briefly as I can. It's a very complicated subject. It's not just electricity, it's also water. It's also the fact that even while this war goes on, over 100 trucks a day are allowed by Israel to cross into Gaza with humanitarian supplies. And it's not a siege. There is no siege. There is no blockade. It's just a controlled, limited flow of goods through the Israeli border and not through the Egyptian border. So if there is any blockade of Gaza, it's the Egyptian blockade of Gaza, not the Israeli blockade of Gaza. But on the specific question of electricity, the reason really for all of this is that Israel, by its own account, does not have an interest in an uncontrollable, total collapse of Gazan society and a humanitarian disaster for which it would be held responsible, a disaster on a scale even greater than the one that is already occurring in Gaza. And so this may be a unique case, but everything about this is a unique case. It's just one more issue that is ironic and paradoxical, but nobody can figure out how to get past it. I'll let Jeff answer, and if you want to have a last word on that. Jeff, answer the issue
munitions.
About Israel running out of munitions, and then Beth will have the last word. And thank you for your patience and attention, all of you.
The munitions subject's a pretty good one, right? Not directly on point to your question, but two things you haven't heard about in this conflict, right? White phosphorus, incendiary weapons being used against the Palestinians, no reporting, even by the legion of reporters inside Gaza, no reporting of fragmentation weapons being used against the population, one report of tank flechette rounds being used. Okay, so those are munitions issues that haven't come up in this war. Dogs that haven't barked. There is a question about the in terms of Iron Dome interceptors, right? You know, how many Iron Dome, and this is a secret, I think, is how many Iron Dome interceptors does Israel actually have, and how fast can they be built and so on relative to the size of Hamas's arsenal. Based on the shoot down rates, right, they need about, for every Hamas rocket, they need about one they need one rock, one interceptor for every five rockets or every four rockets or so. So that's, it depends about how many they had stockpiled, how fast they can be built and so on. No indication that they're conserving fire that I've seen, letting some rockets go through that they might otherwise have intercepted. That would be, if they ran out of interceptors, that would be another game changer. My sense is the Israelis are going to be able to sustain Iron Dome fire for a long time relative to the current threat that the Hamas is presenting. Again, the real problem for them becomes if Hamas can actually significantly increase the accuracy of the rockets, so the more rockets are threats.
Mm-hmm. Last word goes to Beth Omri.
Just maybe a note on this. Just as I was coming here, read the news report that the U.S. that Israel has asked the U.S. for a certain amount for spare parts for the Iron Dome. So there are issues coming up on the Gaza blockade, closure, siege regime thing, whatever you want to call it. I mean, I don't think it's fair also to say that there is no blockage whatsoever. I mean, we all remember the story of, the rice and macaroni or rice and pasta story where, yes, there are certain things where are done for clear security reasons. There are things that are blocked for things which are less obvious security reasons. It's clear that this regime that was there has collapsed, the middle class in Gaza has collapsed. Some of these places where you'd have thought that some of the opposition to Hamas would emerge from. On the electricity, in addition to what you said, that Israel doesn't want a total collapse, for what it matters, and doesn't matter much in this conflict, but under international law, Israel is still the occupying power in Gaza and has a legal responsibility to provide assistance. Some people might not like this, but this is, this is a legal statement. This is not a value statement here.
Okay. We're already over time, so even though you just raised the whole new hornet's nest of issues,
the Middle East,
I think that'll be good material for the next panel.
The next Gaza War.
Which unfortunately I'm afraid we will have to on the same subject. So thank you very much, all of you, for your participation.